We have spoken a lot about measuring force in our athlete testing series, but what about how quickly our athletes are generating this force? Well, we can get insight into this via rate of force development, and that is a really useful way to assess our athletes' explosive ability. I'm Joe Clubb, founder and sports scientist at Global Performance Insights, which is a company providing sports science consultancy to sports teams, sports tech companies, athletes, and practitioners all around the world. So rate of force development refers to how quickly an individual can generate force. If we think about the force time curve, people cannot instantly create their maximum force. There is this curved relationship. As time progresses, force increases. So it normally takes a couple of seconds to reach maximum force. But if we can increase rate of force development, the rate at which we are developing our force, then we can reach that maximum force quicker. But also, most athletic movements don't allow the time required to reach maximum force. So if we're increasing rate of force development in our athletes, perhaps they don't have the time to get to maximum, but they are able to achieve a higher level of force in a shorter time period, which can have a positive impact on athletic performance. So there's an array of different technologies and tools available to us to assess rate of force development in different demands. If assessing rate of force development in the counter movement juck, then we're going to get an RFD measure in both the concentric phase and the eccentric phase. For more on that, then have a look at my video on jump testing, because today we're going to focus on some examples of RFD in the isometric options. With our isometric tests, then we can use technologies such as handheld dynamometers like Wild's Dynamo Range, as well as force plates like Wild's Force Decks, to assess both the maximum force capacity as well as rate of force development during a whole range of isometric tests, such as the isometric midside pull, or perhaps the ASH shoulder test would be another example. Now, we're going to focus on some examples here of the isometric midside pull, which is perhaps one of the most common tests for analyzing an individual's rate of force development. This figure is taken from Claire Brady's 2018 review in the Sports Biomechanics Journal. This is the shape of an isometric midside pull test with force on the y-axis against time in the x-axis. We have a pretty quiet phase, a standard measure of their body weight at the start of the test. That's what that vertical force just greater than 1,000 newtons represents. Before a sharp curve where the isometric midside pull begins, increasing to a peak force measure early in the test, a plateau of a couple of seconds as that pull is held before then the drop back down to just body mass. We can see here rate of force development highlighted in this period as the change in force over the change in time. Essentially, we are assessing the slope of the force time curve to understand the rate at which force is produced. Now, we might think that we want to look at the peak rate of force development across that whole time period as force is increasing, or perhaps the average rate of force development. Interestingly enough, this paper by Professor Greg Hath showed that there was questionable reliability in the overall peak of rate of force development and the average rate of force development. And actually, it's better to take the rate of force development between two set time periods. So that is why when we look at the RFD measures available on the Vold Hub, we see this list of different RFD measures at these set time points, for instance, ranging from 0 to 30 or from 100 to 150 milliseconds. We tend to see better reliability by using these set cutoff thresholds. We can get these as well between left and right, and then all the asymmetry measures associated. So really, when we're using these RFD measures, we are zooming right in on that force time curve. And here we have a figure taken from Dr. Nicola Maffuletti's invited review in 2016, highlighting some of these different RFD measures between these set time periods. Let's not forget then that 50 milliseconds is the same as 0.05 seconds. And even when we extend out to 250 milliseconds, that's still only relating to a 0.25 second window. So here we have an isometric mid-side pause from an individual, a single trial, and we can see their force time curve here then. This individual is around 97 kilos, so that explains this initial force. This individual then pulled a maximum peak vertical force of around 4,700 newtons. Their rate of force development between 0 and 100 milliseconds was 1775 newtons per second. Now, this force at 100 milliseconds measure for this individual is 1218 newtons. But remember that that includes their body weight. When we look at this with the net force value via Vol's hub, then we can see that that is 177. This individual within the first 100 milliseconds of the mid-side pull has generated 177 newtons of force. We divide that by this 100 milliseconds, convert it to newtons per second rather than per millisecond, and that gives us our rate of force development of 1,775. Now, there are issues associated with rate of force development, and sometimes we can get questionable reliability via this measure. Now, of course, as with all our testing, the best way to improve our reliability is to use consistent testing protocols, to always conduct the test, set up the equipment in the same way, use a warm-up, and make sure our athletes are familiar with the test. One really important factor for RFD specifically in terms of reliability is how you cue the test. I've spoken about this before in my isometric mid-side pull video because I think it's an important intentional decision really that you have to make, which is if you want to assess RFD in an isometric mid-side pull, then you need to cue your athletes to pull hard and fast so that they are then trying to increase their force as quickly as possible. An alternative way of assessing the isometric mid-side pull is to not worry about RFD and cue your athletes to gradually build up to their maximum force, knowing then that you're not going to get an assessment of RFD. So what might determine which way, which method you use? For me, it's mostly around the familiarization. If isometric mid-side pull is a newer test for your population, then perhaps you want to just take slightly safer route of just cueing a gradual build-up. If you are hoping to use RFD, then one of the ways that we can actually assess the reliability with our own data set is to look at the coefficient of variation. Firstly, this athlete, we can see their RFD, in this case, up to that 200 millisecond window. We can see pretty consistent outputs all around 6,000 newtons per second RFD and a coefficient of variation of around 5%. Often in research, a coefficient of variation of less than 10% is targeted in terms of acceptable reliability. Alternatively, here we have another athlete where we can see much larger variation and in fact, a difference of 25%. So arguably here, we're not really sure of these numbers. Using the average is unrealistic, but we're not really sure which trials are best representative of their RFD. Now, why might we be seeing this kind of variation? So here we have the force time curve for this individual. In fact, across all three trials is the dip in the force right before the start of the movement. You can see a quiet period where they're just standing still, slight bit of oscillation there where they're probably shifting, getting themselves ready, but then a dip in their body mass as represented with the force time curve here. To me, that signifies some sort of movement. There's some sort of counter movement. Likely they have bent their knees or shifted in some way. And because that force actually goes lower than their body mass due to this counter movement, we're getting some inaccurate RFD values. And I would in fact be looking to redo these trials. So if you can collect valid and reliable RFD data, then it can be really useful from both a performance profiling perspective, as well as even the understanding RFD. That can potentially help guide our programming because different training methods can have different impacts and influences on an individual's RFD capacity. Maximum strength training then raises the ceiling, allows an individual to produce higher peak force in the same time frame. Whereas explosive training requires force to be produced in shorter time frames and therefore allows an athlete to reach peak force faster or a higher force in the same set time frame. Then it can also provide our baseline information for use in rehab should our athlete suffer an injury, because generally in rehab, athletes will recover peak force first, but often it's the rate of force development, these explosive capacities that lag behind in rehab. So this can be a useful measure to track in that setting as well. I hope you found this video useful. And if you did, please hit like and subscribe to make sure you don't miss out on another one. And a massive thank you to Vel Performance for sponsoring this video, this whole series,